What's up, everybody, and welcome to IGN Game Scoop. I'm your host this week, Samuel Claiborn, and I'm filling in for Damon, who's out just this week. Joining me this week are Rebekah Valentine, John Davison, and Miranda Sanchez. We've got a masterpiece show for you this week. We're going to be talking about this insanely crazy week of console war news. It's just one of the most consequential and funniest ever weeks, I think, ever in the history of game news. It's just been crazy. We will also get some console wars history going here, too, from John, who covered some of the earlier console warrings. But first, last week, Nintendo announced a bunch of games, and we commented on them, but this panel didn't get to, and I want to hear their opinions. So to that end, I'm going to go ahead and start with Miranda, because, as I mentioned to you before the show, we didn't get to say the P word at all last week, which could either be Pikachu or Pokemon, but we didn't talk about those games. So what are your thoughts on those announcements?
Yay, Pokemon. This is me showing off my tattoo. It's Pokemon. Yeah, I was exclusively brought here to talk about Detective Pikachu.
And if you missed not exclusively.
No. I can tell you about
you are very good at selling us on Detective Pikachu because you like the first game a lot, if I'm mistaken.
Yes, yeah. I feel like I'm like one of the only people who is excited for Detective Pikachu. Yeah. I reviewed the first game, really enjoyed it. It's definitely a good puzzle game for kids. And if you like puzzles at all, it's a good time. But also if you just like Pokemon and the world of Pokemon specifically, this showcases that life in a way we don't really see in the other games. Mainline games, you get to mostly battle. Like, that's such a big part of it. Seeing how Pokemon live within the world and exist in like chores and as friends and as shop companions just doesn't really exist in that same extent as you see in Detective Pikachu, because it's all about the relationships between people and Pokemon, and that is like by far the biggest highlight of that entire game. And it's a fun adventure, it's really weird, and you know, it takes Pikachu into a very different kind of role. Like, I learned about coffee from that game, which I know some things about coffee. Like, my dad's super into it, like he'd roast his own beans. Like, I grew up having good
and
coffee.
This is because Detective Pikachu is obsessed with coffee, as yes. I glean from the trailer.
Yes, loves coffee. Mm-hmm. It is like a big
deal. What did
deal.
You learn about coffee?
I forget. I did learn things. It's been years.
There's nerdy coffee details, yeah, there, basically.
So it's been years, and it's just a really charming game. And my biggest point of excitement for this was because we learned about this in 2019, that it was getting a sequel. Nintendo announced it. Nothing. Just nothing since then. And so because the movie was sort of like, oh, people liked it, but they're probably not going to do a sequel.
Great movie.
Yeah. I super enjoyed it.
That's the thing. Like, I feel like the original Detective Pikachu, it looked fine, but I didn't give it too much of a second thought. And then the movie came out and I loved the movie. And I think I assumed that the game was very different from the movie. And I have been told it's not that much.
Is, but also not. It's obviously more expanded in its story, yeah, and its cases, and I think the movie does a good job of picking out some of the best parts of it and interpreting it in its own way. Of
course, it definitely shows what you're talking about, though, that weird idea of like Pokemon integration in the world,
yeah,
which is like, it's part of the anime, right? And like, I remember being like young and like watching that and being like, oh, this is really interesting. They use Diglets to make dams or whatever. Like, there's like stuff like that, but like, this is like, it's like they had a fantasy premise that's a little bit goofy, and they tried to make it a little bit more realistic. And it's like, just watching that process is really amusing to me.
Yeah, and I think getting to experience that in a more focused way was just a lot of fun. So seeing it get announced suddenly at the top, I was like, this is great.
Yeah, I've never been this excited at 7:30. It was vaporware for a while, right?
It was, yeah. Yeah. Congratulations. Happy birthday, Miranda.
Thank you. Yeah, so yeah.
Was there also Pokemon DLC announced in this one? That's right?
So it wasn't announced. It was just an update.
Okay.
Like, it's just more information on the DLC.
Well, we saw it for the first time. This is the first time we've seen gameplay.
Yes. Yeah. So more details, but honestly, I'm like, until we get it, it doesn't really matter. Like,
yeah, no,
what's
true.
It going to look like? It's going to look like the rest of the game, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I think that's more of what
looks
it
bad.
Is. Yeah, which is a nice thing for them to start with, right? It's like a known quantity. Like, here's some more information.
Is that game working any better?
No.
After your review?
No. I heard that. Well, there was a patch this week, right? But I'm not optimistic.
I haven't played in a while.
Nobody's come
out
and been like, hey, this game is like completely been rebuilt from the ground up.
No, yeah. No. I played.
That's not going to happen.
I went back and played again after I think the first couple patches had hit, and it was still the same. Like, the, like they fixed
the level of Arceus should be possible, right?
They fixed some of the worst like bugs that were going on, I think, in raids and competitive that were just like actively crashing the game for people.
Some stuff with you. Remember that?
Yeah.
And we got it, and you were, yeah. just, you were just warping around the scenery.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, that's still happening.
I just want it to be pretty. Like,
no.
Yeah. Pokemon's not pretty. It's not a pretty game.
No.
Like, I don't think it's stylized enough like Zelda is to be like that.
I think the Detective Pikachu movie was pretty stylized and looked pretty good.
That was
like a good version.
I have seen some people complaining about the Detective Pikachu graphics of them not looking very nice, which I'm like, yeah, I basically don't expect any Switch game to look nice. Like, that is my level of coming into it, which maybe seems unfair, but all my favorite games just look kind of fine or are highly stylized so they look nice on the system.
Yeah, so you're pleasantly surprised when it's like, this is a beautiful moment.
Yeah.
I think that's a shame, though, because, like, look, Pokemon used to look really nice, and it wasn't because the things we were playing on were particularly technically advanced. It was because we had certain expectations about handheld systems, and they had this art style, this wonderful sprite work that fit within the confines of those systems, and they were doing, like, this really beautiful art, and they were doing interesting... Like, I mean, remember Pokemon X and Y, and, like, the colors are...
That was probably the height of Pokemon looking good, because Game
Black and White. Black and White, I think, was.
Looked great, yeah.
Yeah, that was a really good-looking game. I did the guides for those too. Those were really interesting games.
Yeah.
Good Pokemon. That's where they introduced that Vanilluxe.
And you see, this is a conversation is why Nintendo was not in the console wars. Because
But is it?
That would be a good segue, but we can't get there yet because I did want to get John and Reb's thoughts on that show. Anything exciting to you for this fall?
Well, I'm a big Luigi's Mansion fan. Yeah. However, I am getting a little tired of the same old stuff getting remade.
So they took
everywhere
to Dark Moon and brought it to Switch.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Which is a great game, but
you already played it.
I already played it, and it was pretty good the first time around. There's just this obsession lately on all the platforms of like, oh, we got to go back and make the best stuff work on the new hardware, and it's like, can't we just do that through backward compatibility and like focus on that? And there are plenty of great ideas in the Luigi's Mansion games to create a new story rather than just retreading an old one.
I think maybe with Dark Moon in particular, because I think their problem with backwards compatibility as an option is because it was on the 3DS, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like they can't just say.
I get it. I just feel like we're going through this phase right now where all the platform holders are guilty of this to some extent, where we're just going back and having do-overs on things rather than moving it forward. And like Luigi's Mansion is one of those kind of secondary series where if you've played it, and not a huge number of people have, everyone I know that's played any of the Luigi's Mansion games loves it, right?
Yeah,
and like this one was fantastic, the Switch one, you know, the more recent one was fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
But not many people talk about it. So when you say, oh, well, like, what's one of your favorite Nintendo games? Oh, I love the Luigi's Mansion. And people are like, really?
Mm-hmm. Well, because it came out with that very like middling impression because it was a GameCube launch game and it wasn't a big Mario game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And people like from then on felt, I think, a little bit burnt by it. But it's definitely improved, you know, over the years. And it's always one of the best looking Nintendo games.
It's a great looking game. I think it has the most well-developed sense of humor and character particularly anything in the Mario universe, right? Like Luigi is a fully formed personality.
Yes, totally. That's
Mario
really accurate.
Mario is a shell.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so is Peach and Toad, unfortunately. Yeah. But Captain Toad is an
interesting
character.
Captain Toad's
different. Yeah. It's also structurally unique. Like there's not really any, I mean, it's an adventure puzzler kind of, but it, there's not really, there are not Luigi's Mansion likes out there. It is its own thing.
Yeah. And tonally it's so different.
Like
saying that it's spooky, but it's fun. And you just don't see that in games a lot. Like if it's spooky, it's horrifying. There's not a fun half step.
And this has little jump scares in it, and it has sinister character. But I mean, what was interesting about the 3DS version specifically was it had that sense of depth, and some of the puzzles were understanding where in the 3D environment the thing that you needed to do was, because sometimes it was on a wall that was facing into the room and you had to stand in the right place so you could see the thing in the mirror. Mm-hmm. And it was actually, using the environment
the fourth wall.
It was using the fourth wall, so there's actually a hidden door like here that I have to get around to.
Yeah.
And the fact that the screen had some depth actually sort of added to the significance of that.
Yeah, yeah.
And we're going to lose that a little bit on the port.
Yeah. And the map. It strikes me that one thing that would be really great is if these games, and Mario RPG is like this too, if they're pulled into the present with a remake or like a, you know, a recast like this, it's always nice if they add like a master mode or like some kind of like layer over it, which adds something else, like a super difficult mode or something like that would be such a good way to bring these games back and a reason to, but that becomes really rare. So then you got to turn to the games like Resident Evil 4 Remake, which is like 100% remake with like crazy arcade stuff added to it and everything like that. That like there's a way between those. You don't have to just do your straight stretch to the Switch screen, or like the full thing. But people aren't doing that very much. But Ocarina of Time did. It was really good. It was called Master Mode. It was really fun. The Master Quest. That's what it was called for that one.
There's a lot of Master something in Zelda, so it's easy to get those confused.
Totally. I know. where are you at with the Nintendo fall lineup or beyond?
I think I'm kind of with John. I'm a huge Nintendo fan. Like Nintendo is probably where I'm on NBC like a lot. Nintendo is probably my console of choice. I was actually kind of bummed out by that direct. I was looking at my watch
see
over.
See out there, everybody, you came down on me. Not
I'm
everybody
sorry.
Loves Nintendo was
I'm
super
sorry.
Into that direct. There wasn't something for everybody in that one.
No, and there's some good highlights. Like I have played a little bit of Mario RPG, but I've never played it in full. I am excited to sort of be handed an opportunity to do so again. I think that'll be great. Curious about the Peach game. Wish we could have seen more. Was there a date on that? Is that next year?
And like it's
nothing.
All they showed was Peach just kind of like running around a stage.
Yeah,
it's interesting because Mario 3 is all set up like a stage. So I think that's really cool.
I think they said it was next year.
Okay. There was one.
That and Dark Moon were next year.
That's right. But yeah, like it was all just stuff that was kind of either kind of far off in that sense, or as John said, remakes, or there were a lot of ports in there. There was just a lot that I was kind of like, okay, yeah. Like this could have been an email almost.
How funny. Dare you?
I'm sorry.
Wow.
I'm sorry.
Detective Pikachu deserves time in the spotlight.
Detective Pikachu was great. It was nice to actually see gameplay of the Pokemon DLC, Mario RPG, and Peach.
Nobody's mentioned Mario Wonder. Anybody in
Oh, right.
The one where, okay, I can say it here because we're not on the live stream, but it's the one where Mario gets high, basically. Like, that's what it is.
Yeah, if it's like a psychedelic Mario game, it'll be really cool.
That's really what it is. That's what it looks like to me.
Yeah. I don't know. You know, it'll be fine. Tears of the Kingdom.
Yeah, Tears of the Kingdom. That's the
For
thing.
The next, like, 5 years.
Yeah.
That was their big game this
I'm
year.
I'm fine.
It's out. And they have other games. It's just the big one just happened.
Yeah.
So that's
okay.
Why I think this direct focusing on mostly this year is just not going to be as exciting for a lot of folks.
You know what it was? It wasn't that I don't think Mario Wonder isn't exciting or that the Peach game isn't exciting. It's that all of their big things right now are Mario. And I like Mario. Mario, great. But all of these big things are Mario and they all kind of fall into the same bucket for me. And so I see one Mario and I'm like, great, we have a Mario. And then I'm wondering what else is coming. And
I guess it's smart after
Mario.
The movie to double down on Mario.
I suppose.
But that just means that there's something that they're going to show in their next direct this fall or something, which will be really exciting for the other properties, right?
It's okay. They're fine.
Throughout the past 2 weeks, Reb's been reporting from court here in San Francisco on the trial that the FTC is testing Microsoft for monopolistic practices in acquiring Activision. What we're going to do is talk about some of the highlights of that trial by playing something of a game, which we can all participate in. But basically, I have 23 headlines from the trial here.
So many.
Mainly originating with Reb. And then we have lots of roundups and stuff on IGN, so check those out. But to kind of recap, right now we're at the place where the trial has concluded arguments, and so there'll be a verdict next week. So we can talk about everything we learned in basically exposing evidence and then in witness interviews. And so that's where all these headlines are coming from. And what they're giving us is the best sense possible on how Microsoft and Sony think of themselves and think of each other, because we actually get to see the emails from top brass at either once to each other, for example. So that's kind of the context. I probably didn't do it justice, but Reb can add a lot more. So we're going to start with a really, really funny one here. As again, I'm going to read down some headlines, and she's going to give us a lightning round of context, and we can talk about them. All right, so Microsoft admits Xbox has lost the console wars.
This is delightful. This is kind of, I'm pretty sure that specific line is from some written testimony, but they've said it repeatedly in a bunch of places. They're basically for the purposes of this case, trying to make themselves look like, oh, we're very, very small, really. And if we acquired Activision, we would just be competing fairly in the market because we're just so small and we're really not a big gaming company. And we've seen kind of some similar, oh, look at us. We're so sad. If we lose Call of Duty, we're going to be destroyed by Sony to sort of counter that. So there's a little bit of back and forth there. But yeah, they're basically saying, oh, yeah, we lost the console wars because Xbox sold the least of Switch, Xbox Series, and PlayStation 5, therefore.
And that would be starting with the... Okay, so that's talking about this console generation.
Statements to all of these effects. They're saying, we have lost the current console wars, we have lost the past console wars, we are losing the console war.
I mean, clearly that's a goofy concept, right?
Yeah.
why haven't they given up then, right? Is the immediate follow-up question you have to that. Well, it's because they have to, as you said, represent themselves in a specific way.
It's wild that the phrase console wars is just this matter of public record and debate in a serious court case. It's so weird.
Heck yeah.
To be in there and hear
the greatest thing ever.
Hear someone on the stand, what the FTC or whatever. Do you admit that you have lost the console wars? What?
Yeah. All right, so here's another one. So Pete Hines, who you can mention who that is after this, says Starfield wouldn't be out in 9 weeks if it was releasing on the PS5.
Yeah, Pete Hines. But what's his actual title at Bethesda ZeniMax? He's upper...
Isn't he head of publishing now?
Yeah, publishing.
He used to be comms and marketing, yeah.
Yeah, well, he's important at Bethesda ZeniMax, whatever. But he's... He was talking about there's this whole back and forth about Starfield exclusivity, and they were kind of, FTC was trying to corner him a little bit, talking about Starfield being exclusive to Xbox, basically, and how that was horrible and harmful. Mm-hmm. And Pete Hines's kind of counter to that on the witness stand was that if he had to put it on PlayStation 5, it wouldn't be coming out 9 weeks from when he was having this conversation because it would take so much longer to develop and be so much work. So one of the advantages of having it be exclusive is he's able to release it sooner.
And that's an interesting thing to point out, that if there's any advantage to having an exclusive that's tied to like what just getting the game out faster, because there's a lot of other reasons to have exclusives and a lot of other reasons to not have exclusives. But I just thought that was interesting. That was like, well, this wouldn't be out in 9 weeks.
So Pete Hines is the head of publishing.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Miranda. Mm-hmm. All right. Here's another one. This is just kind of surprising because there's just news out of this that we didn't expect to kind of talk about. One is that Microsoft expects the next generation of consoles to come out in 2028. You heard it here. 2028.
Yeah, that was funny. We almost accidentally glossed over that because it was such a throwaway thing. It was in some documents that Microsoft released as part of evidence. But they had, I pulled up the line here to make sure I got it right. They just had this casual throwaway line where they said, this term would in any case go beyond the expected starting period of the next generation of consoles, parentheses, in 2028. Talking about Call of Duty, the 10-year exclusivity promise that it made.
I think that's bullshit. Sorry, I get it.
Which part?
The 2028.
Yeah.
I think that is a construct to stretch out the victim positioning. Mm. There's no way the next one's 2028. It's going to be way sooner than that.
I wouldn't be shocked.
So it's better for them.
It's better for them to say, we're screwed for like 5 more years. We have to do this.
Yeah. So it's Microsoft saying this. And so they're trying to make it sound like, okay, well, we offered them 10 years of Call of Duty. And that means Call of Duty is going to be on the next generation of consoles. Therefore, our 10-year promise is extremely generous. But I think you're probably right. Like the next gen of consoles in 2020, as soon as 2028, seems like it may be a little bit silly. I wouldn't be surprised if we had a 0.5 by then, a PS5.
I mean, that would be an eight year generation before a turnover, which, I mean, I know they're all striving for 10, but usually the waning years are extending out.
Do you think that's not exacerbated a little bit just because of COVID?
Oh, I super think it.
2028, this generation of hardware is going to be woefully out of date.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
So there's the pressure, yeah.
We're already seeing issues with it, so.
Yeah. It's hard to say. I think it's a made up, I think it's maybe an aspirational year. I don't know that it's
but I think it's part of the narrative they're trying to spin it, like, we're going to be behind for a long time.
Yeah.
And it's 2028 sounds like a long time from now. And also, it'd be a long time to wait for a new Switch. Let's Right.
Well, but Switch isn't in this.
Sam,
remember,
a Switch is not a Gen 9 console, according to a bunch of these people.
It was a pretty good joke. All right. So the next one we have Sarah Bond from Xbox says Xbox Cloud is Game Pass Ultimate's least popular feature. So this is somebody at Xbox saying,
yeah,
Xbox Cloud is not popular.
In part of the sort of ongoing woe is us, we can't make anything good argument, there was a lot of discussion of Xbox Cloud, their cloud features just being terrible. Just them saying, yeah, we tried. This was our bet on mobile. We didn't have a mobile market. Mobile gaming was going up. We were trying to put something on mobile, so we made this Xbox Cloud system where you can play, you know, whatever console games on your mobile phones using cloud, and nobody uses it. It sucks, apparently. They said the Sarah Bond and several others made the arguments that the majority of people who are using xCloud are using it where they have bought a new game, or they're trying to play a new game. They're in the middle of downloading it, and while they're downloading it, they're playing the game they just got on the cloud, and then as soon as it's done downloading, they're playing it natively.
I never thought to do that.
Yeah.
That's not a bad idea.
Apparently what people are doing. Yeah, it's a great idea.
It's also great for sampling, if you're like, not sure. You stream the game from Game Pass and see if you like it and then download
okay.
it.
One of the major uses I've personally had for it is playing games that are not on PC through the cloud on PC. So like I was trying to play, I think it was like Gears 2 or something with my sister, and I had to use the cloud version so that way I can play with her.
You just use Xbox controller on your PC.
It's super easy.
No problem.
Yeah.
I'm sure Samsung, who just put an Xbox Game Pass app on every television they sell, are thrilled to hear that Microsoft think it sucks.
Yeah. I mean, that came up a little bit. No, it was sort of interesting after, because the decision in the UK, the CMA decided that, well, Call of Duty is not an issue. Cloud gaming is an issue. Mm-hmm. Cloud gaming really just got glossed over.
That's a good point. I didn't think about that context, is that it's what it came down to, is the cloud gaming stuff.
In the UK. Yeah. But here, like, I mean, we'll talk about closing arguments in a minute, but we got to closing arguments. We talked for about an hour and a half about Call of Duty, and then the judge says, all right, I want to get to cloud. Talked for about 5 minutes about cloud, and then immediately back to Call of Duty. So it's weird. I think Xbox managed to divert everyone away from cloud, accurately or not, I don't know, but
Here's probably one of the best courtroom moments from what I've talked to you about already. So this is a Xbox boss, Phil Spencer, tells judge, I will do whatever it takes to keep Call of Duty on PlayStation.
Yeah, that was actually
what was happening in there?
It was a fairly powerful moment. It was when Phil Spencer was up on the witness stand, and you know, they were talking about, he was being questioned over and over again by everybody about Call of Duty. And you know, he's made these 10-year commitments. He's tried to make this 10-year promise to Sony, and they haven't accepted it, and they've gone back and forth. And he was being asked for, the Microsoft lawyers were doing this. They were questioning him about how serious he was and his commitment to keep Call of Duty on PlayStation, and you know, even without the contract. And he got up there and promised he would do it. And then the judge like looked at him and did the courtroom thing of, you know, you're under oath, right?
I can't believe that moment occurred.
Yeah, it was kind of incredible. And so he's now like on record under oath promising that he's going to keep Call of Duty on PlayStation. And
until a year, did he give a year?
I mean, I can put, if you,
no, no, sorry,
I can
no,
look
he,
it up.
He didn't have to, because he said he'd do everything he could. That was his promise.
Yeah.
And it's out of his hands.
Well, and later on, you know, the FTC.
You got to make that release date in the fall, right? And if you think you can't, they got to take it off PlayStation.
Well, and it was interesting because the FTC got up to do their cross-examination, and they were trying to poke at him and be like, okay, well, but you have this contract that you offered to them, and it's got a bunch of terms in it. What if they try to offer you unfavorable terms to do that? And he's like, well, we've released games on PlayStation before. Like, we have a pretty standard publishing agreement. So even if they don't sign this 10-year deal, we're still going to try to publish Call of Duty on Sony platforms, like in the same way that we do with a bunch of other games all the time. And he kept just poking at him with like all these hypotheticals, like, okay, well, what if this thing happens, or what if technology doesn't work, all these different things. And finally the judge like stopped this line of questioning, because she's like, okay, like you're asking this man to like swear under oath that he's going to keep Call of Duty on PlayStation even if PlayStation makes it impossible for him to do that. And you can't, that's not fair. She stopped that.
Did they poke at the just sort of obvious money of it? I mean, of the $1 billion in revenue that Call of Duty does every year, didn't they say that $800 million of it is versions on PlayStation. Yes.
I know I'm going to get
out. If you're buying a business, why would you go, you know what? You know, the majority of the revenue for this game that's the biggest thing in the world, we're just going to turn that off.
I mean, the revenue part came up too when it came down to ZeniMax, right?
Yeah.
When they're saying like, oh, Phil Spencer decided that they're not publishing to PlayStation. There were conversations about how that was going to hurt their prospective revenue that they had planned for.
But
when
if you're spending
them.
$64 billion dollars on a company,
exactly,
you need it. You need that money back.
Yeah,
yeah. It's.
You want me to skip to those headlines?
Sure, if you want. Yeah,
and I'll go back to the other ones. All right. Yeah. So to what John was just talking about is there was two headlines about accidental reveals, as I mentioned at the top of this. One is that Sony accidentally reveals that Call of Duty is worth $800 million to PlayStation alone. So that's one. And then The Last of Us 2 and Horizon Forbidden West budgets accidentally revealed in poorly redacted document. So what I wanted to ask you about both of those as a pair is that why are these things being accidentally revealed? How would that even occur? And what happened in there?
Oh, so part of these trials is that evidence is submitted for these trials. And evidence is generally a matter a public trial is a matter of public record, and so you can access it. Now, normally, evidence is not, you can't just go online and find evidence for whatever trial you want, but you can do I don't know what FOIA stands for, Federal or Open...
Freedom of Information.
Yeah. Freedom of Information Act request to request this information. But, and it's kind of time consuming, you have to go through this whole process, fill out a form, do these emails. This is kind of a painstaking process, and I think they understood that a lot of reporters were going to be asking for this anyway. Mm-hmm. And so they dropped a folder online. They did this in the Epic Apple trial as well, where they just dropped all the evidence so that they just wouldn't have to deal with all these records requests. Right. So this folder's online and they're dropping it. And obviously there's, you know, proprietary information in some of these documents. And so both parties and the third parties who are working with them to supply this evidence are redacting things, basically removing, you know, really specific numbers, financial things, things that, you know, you don't want to reveal to the public.
Which would be newsy if they...
It would be very newsy if they did. Yeah. And most of them, you know, when they're redacted, it's just kind of like this black box around things they don't want us to see that you can't see through. But somebody, possibly from Sony, unclear, redacted several documents with a Sharpie and then scanned them. Mm-hmm. And when you redact with like a Sharpie that isn't quite full of ink, you know, you can see through it. I mean, you can see, if you're watching the video, you can see through this poorly sharpened document. And so this is what happened.
Amazing B-roll, Jobert. Thank you for that.
Whoever did this. And so, you know, all these numbers got revealed and put online where anybody could find them. And a bunch of articles got written about them. And between this and a couple other documents that were not fully redacted, like there was, we're going to get to it in a minute, but there was a document about acquisitions that should have had tons of black boxes over it and had like zero. Between all of that, they eventually ripped the evidence folder off the internet. And I've been refreshing every day, hoping for it to come back. Show us the emails, Microsoft and Sony.
The damage was done, if it was damage at all, in the sense that we reported on it because we got to.
We did.
There's so much good stationery out there. Is it a dry Sharpie? Like, thank you, but also like, Sharpie. Damn, guys, let me introduce you to white-on washi tape. There's a lot out there.
Miranda would never poorly redact a document. Yeah, you'd be thorough about it. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I just feel bad for the, you know, paralegal, whoever who was doing that redacting. Oh, yeah. That's unfortunate. Speaking of what you were just referring to, Microsoft considered buying Final Fantasy maker Square Enix. So that's pretty big news. What's the context behind that?
Yeah, that one, I believe, was actually from an email. So there was an email that, you know, got dropped into evidence where they talked about potentially buying Square Enix,
okay,
I believe.
Okay, so it wasn't in the acquisitions thing you were just talking about.
It wasn't, but it was sort of the larger narrative is that there was another document that got dropped in there that was sort of their big presentation an internal presentation they were doing of all of these companies that they could potentially buy. And they basically had a list of like 100 different companies. Mm-hmm. And then they put it through a funnel, like narrowing it down, like, okay, these are too expensive. We can't buy these. These would never let us buy them for these reasons. Ooh. Knock the microphone.
And they fulfill certain audience needs.
Right, yeah, these don't.
There's like all of the, like, can you imagine like this behind the scenes look at like that high level of corporate function. Like, we just don't see that.
No, we don't. But they wanted to buy Square Enix. They also got very serious briefly about buying Sega. So those rumors a couple of years ago that Phil Spencer really wanted to buy a Japanese company were absolutely true.
But then Sega said,
no, we're not up for sale.
We're not. And they still say that, right?
Yeah, they're still saying that. We
weren't for sale then. We're not now.
Yeah. And there are a bunch of other companies, too, that they were talking about buying, but some of which they, you know, might still be interested in. Who can say?
All right. Two more. One, Sony boss Jim Ryan says, many publishers believe Xbox Game Pass is value destructive.
That was funny. So Jim Ryan said that. Mm-hmm. And it's hard.
Jim Ryan's Sony
said that.
Let's make that clear.
Yeah, so he says many publishers believe Game Pass is value destructive. He said that during his video deposition. Hard to tell who many publishers is. I believe we already had an article come out this morning where like somebody from I think it's the Football Manager people.
Sports Interactive?
I haven't read this. Okay. I feel bad. There's an article came out this morning where somebody from a publisher was like, no, actually we love Game Pass.
And this has been a back and forth.
It has been.
Something that publicly, you know, some companies have said, I wish we wouldn't have gone with Game Pass. There have been some people that say that and some people that are saying we very much like Game Pass.
Yeah, but it's
a different earning structure for your game, right?
Yes.
You know who people really have regrets likes sometimes. Game Pass though?
Who?
Consumers.
Yeah.
People who can just
That's absolutely right.
Yeah, an easy sub and get so many games.
Wasn't there some comment from Phil that every game that there was something like every game that just hit Game Pass is from a like previous Game Pass publisher?
I don't think it's every game, but like I know what you're talking about. Yeah,
percentage of like
a large percentage
are repeats.
Yes, so they come back.
Surely they liked it.
Yes, a lot of them come back. And I wrote about this a little bit. I think there's like some nuance to be had about who likes Game Pass and who doesn't, because Bobby Kotick also in his testimony admitted that he doesn't like subscriptions.
Well, of course he doesn't. He sells 35 million copies of Call of Duty every year.
Exactly. And so who is it that Jim Ryan's talking to? Well, I bet he's not talking to like indie and AA developers for whom Xbox hands them a big chunk of money and says you're not going to get any unit sales revenues from this, but here's a big chunk of money guaranteed and we'll put your game on Game Pass for this long. I bet they're very happy about it because then they have this guarantee and they don't have to worry about it. But yeah, like if you own Call of Duty, if you own Diablo, if you own Grand Theft Auto, why? I mean, I think Grand Theft Auto has been on Game Pass like super briefly before, but it's also what, 10 years old now. Why would you put these things on Game Pass? You have no need to. You're selling 5 million units a quarter. Who cares?
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, I think for those smaller games, it's such a big discovery aspect, right? Like I maybe would have never played it, but then I played it and I didn't get to finish it, but I loved it. And now I go buy it because I wanted it and I liked it on Game Pass. Like that's such a huge thing. It's like the demo section, except it's everything and it's the full game, but you just don't finish it. You can go back to it.
It does sort of beg the question, you know, I mean, this is like maybe a larger view on the trial, but you know, Xbox has been behind for a while now in a lot of different ways. And Game Pass makes a lot of sense for them. They have the subscription service they're trying to sell to people. They put their first party games on it at launch and it works out for them. But they also don't really have any games yet on the scale of like Call of Duty and Grand Theft Auto where it would be value destructive.
They should buy those Game Pass,
right? So they're supposedly going to put Call of Duty on Game Pass. That seems to be the plan if they can get a hold of it. But, you know, what happens here in 5-10 years if the wheel turns and Xbox ends up on top with these big franchises that don't really need Game Pass? Do they change their model? Does Game Pass get more expensive? And I think that was one of the questions that was introduced during the trial.
Yeah, tiers of Game Pass, maybe pricing, like that. I mean, it can go
so many different
directions. I'm very happy that there's multiple ways to pay for games right now, though, because I got pretty worried once GameStop started closing and everything went digital that like we'd be like paying $60-$70 for like every game all the time, no trade-ins. Oh, yeah. Like that's really tough on people.
It is.
Yeah.
So a thing like Game Pass is a more reasonable way to play a bunch of games.
I think the interesting thing too is how Game Pass is perceived as you get free games because you're already paying for it versus the free-to-play games that are really popular with younger audiences right now.
Yeah.
People want to just be able to download a game and say, I have this and I'm playing it and I didn't have to spend anything. Mm-hmm. And then maybe I get mom and dad's like credit card and then I go pay for some cosmetics. This one offers that illusion of free that I got to download anything like as a kid and just play it.
Yeah.
And so that offers accessibility to something to like a huge market, right? And I think that's an interesting perspective to also consider of how the younger audiences are maybe skewing potentially to free to play and a lot of just general audience people, not even young, right?
Mm. Yeah.
Disney Dreamlight Valley, other stuff. Like, that's all, well, that one you have to pay for early access right now, but will be free.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot there where you just want to get it and play.
Yep.
Versus what, you know, I think core gamers, console audiences and stuff, we expect to have to pay for things. But I think companies like Microsoft are trying to think ahead of, like, how do you capture all of that audience, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's such a big challenge and what they're trying to maybe potentially solve a little bit with Game Pass too.
Yeah. It certainly helps answer the discoverability question at least a little bit, because I knew for a fact that I wanted Tears of the Kingdom, and so I didn't have a problem paying $70 for that outright. But most of the time, I don't know for sure if I want a game. Yeah. Even if I, like, read about it and watch some reviews and stuff like that, I'm still not fully sold. And so, I mean, that's the promise of Game Pass, and that's what they tout, and they're not wrong. Like, I open that up whenever I don't know what to play, and I scroll through, and I pick about three things that sort of catch my interest, and I play, you know, 30 minutes of them and see what I think, and I didn't have to pay for all three of those games. If I hate them, I can just uninstall them. But usually something ends up sticking. And that's pretty powerful.
Yeah. Final headline. This is like more of a funny headline that you have to kind of get the full context for this because it doesn't make any sense. But you'll give us this right now. Experts argue over whether Call of Duty is a unicorn. what's going on here?
I didn't think this was like a massive deal or anything, but it was pretty funny and notable. Both sides had expert testimony from economists who came up and, you know, sort of talked about the economics of how this deal would work, who it would harm, and things like that. And at one point, it was brought up on the FTC side that Call of Duty was a unicorn. It was this extremely special game. There's nothing in the industry like Call of Duty, because it is this thing that comes out every single year, is this fully priced game that's not on any of these subscription services and does so well. It is mm-hmm. so ubiquitous. It tops the charts year after year. It's this franchise. It's a unicorn. There's nothing like it. It's this unique, special, shining thing in the woods.
Take that, Madden.
And FIFA.
Yeah,
right. Bigger.
Who's heard of FIFA? I don't know what that is.
But not in the U.S.
NBA, yeah.
Then Microsoft's expert came up and was sort of trying to debunk these arguments. And she had prepared.
So they have to come up and say why Call of Duty is pretty actually common. It's like commonplace.
Yeah. And her argument was that, like, yes, it is popular. No one's arguing that Call of Duty is not popular or very successful, but it is not this completely unreplicatable thing mm-hmm. that no one has ever done before and no one is ever going to do again. It is a game like any other that just, you know, happens to sell quite a few copies.
They didn't go with the argument, but we have so many players and it's so hard to keep track of all of these players. You have to understand.
Yeah, no, that's all that was about.
Okay, so we have had 2 weeks of arguments, and the final day was actually an encouraged argument between the prosecution and the judge, or the defense and the judge? You said one talked more than the other.
Yeah, so the way it was set up was Judge Corley sort of encouraged them to come back and do their closing arguments, and I think she encouraged them to have an engagement. Mm-hmm.
Originally with each other.
Yeah, originally with each other.
I don't ever picture a court conclusion being like that, where they...
It was kind of a spicy debate. It was pretty cool. At first it started off, the FTC had the floor. This is the FTC's lawyer, James Weingarten. And he got up there and he started kind of giving a little bit of a speech, like one sort of imagines when one imagines a closing argument.
Just like Legally Blonde.
Yes, a little
just
bit.
Just like Legally
Exactly like Legally Blonde, pink and everything. Mm-hmm. And Judge Corley started interjecting and asking questions, which mm-hmm. she's been asking great questions the whole trial. She self-admittedly doesn't know a whole lot about games, and so she was trying to wrap her head around it. And so it slowly started to turn into a back and forth between her and Weingarten, where she was asking questions and picking apart his argument and trying to get some clarity on the parts that she didn't understand. And then at a certain point, Microsoft's lawyer, Beth Wilkinson, started stepping in too and, like, coming up to the mic and saying, "Can I respond to what he just said?" And she'd go ahead.
Interesting.
And so Wilkinson started rebutting, and the two went back and forth a little bit, but a lot of the floor, it was like 3 hours of closing arguments, mm-hmm. and a good chunk of them were devoted to the judge and Weingarten going back and forth.
Okay.
I wouldn't characterize the judge as like argumentative or hostile necessarily.
Sure.
But
inquisitive.
Inquisitive, I think, is right. She clearly had some problems with the arguments he had laid out and wanted to give him the opportunity to clarify. So it was really enlightening on sort of where she stood on the matter, I thought.
Okay. All right. So, and the next week is a decision.
Maybe. I am.
Sometime there's a decision.
I'm not super clear on when we're actually going to get an answer to this. I do not think it will be sooner than next Wednesday because of the holiday and because of when their paperwork deadlines are. But this is clearly a large, weighty decision that she is making, and it might take longer.
It's not a jury decision.
It's not a jury decision. It's just her.
Okay. All right. So let's think about all the things we just talked about and how interesting it is that these companies are all vying for your time to play their video games. It's been that way for a long time. And mm-hmm. John has some statistics about...
I do. All right. So going all the way back to the 1970s.
Mm-hmm. Whoa.
Wow.
The Atari 2600 sold 30 million.
Mm-hmm. Not the first console, but the first hit console.
First hit console. So I didn't want to go sort of into sort of like all the way back, but the first major and things that inform this conversation. So 2600 sold 30 million units, and it beat the Intellivision, the ColecoVision, and the Odyssey 2. Mm. The Intellivision sold 3 million, so 10% of what the winner sold.
Wow.
And then the other two, just 2 million.
Mm. Wow.
And even back then, there were some, and we were watching on YouTube some TV ads, which is like,
we watched an attack ad.
An attack ad from a man in a tweed coat. So I've been playing basketball on Atari, and I just think the Intellivision version looks so much more realistic.
And then there's a Coleco one where they use the term, use the catchphrase, "Sorry, Atari."
I know, yeah.
So that was going on.
Atari did okay.
Here's the sorry Atari commercial.
Miranda, this is like in Tears of the Kingdom when they talk about the ancient imprisoning war 10,000 years ago or whatever
it
is.
Yeah, the
there's
kids
like
really
there's like murals on
look,
the wall.
Look, this guy's jealous of his friend who has a better...
Oh, yeah, and then the hook on the ColecoVision is you can plug it into the Adam personal computer and it's a fully-fledged computer.
Ancient history.
I've never heard of the Odyssey 2, and so I'm looking
so the Odyssey
it up
2,
right now
Well, Odyssey was the first console.
Yeah.
So the Odyssey 2 kind of came back to be like, people want consoles now because they couldn't sell a single Odyssey. Yeah. You know, it was like just...
They put Cappy in that or...
So then subsequent generations, which we're all more familiar with. So the NES sold just shy of 62 million and it beat the Master System, which I didn't actually realize how big the gap between these two was. The Master System only sold 8 million.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's a ratio that's pretty sad for the Master System. And to give you some context, I have heard of Intellivision and ColecoVision growing up. I never even saw or heard of a Master System where I lived.
Right. Mm.
I never even heard of it. Until the Genesis came out, I never heard the word Sega.
So now we're getting into the modern console wars, right? So Genesis versus Super Nintendo, a bit closer. The SNES sold 49 million. The Genesis sold 30.7.
We had a Genesis in my home.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm. It's my first gaming system.
And this is the famous attack ad from Genesis.
Yeah.
Genesis does what Nintendo don't. I'm not going to sing it, but it's sung.
Oh, please do regale us, Sam.
So this is actually, not to skip to the conversation afterwards, but this is basically the declaration of the console wars. This ad is that.
Mm-hmm.
And... basically, the conversation around competing consoles has never been the same since.
Yeah, 100%.
Wow.
Thank you, Sega.
Thanks, Sega.
They're not even involved in it. Like, they did this and then said, bye, what? See ya.
So this was
this week.
This was 1989, this ad.
Wow.
All right, so then it starts getting real interesting when the PlayStation launches.
Oh, wow.
PlayStation launched in 1995. Sold 117 million units, and it beat the Saturn and the N64, which I forgot to write down numbers for, but they were significantly less.
Yeah.
Well, Saturn for sure. Let me look up N64 numbers while you do your next one.
Good old N64.
So then we move on to the PlayStation 2. 155 million, arguably the greatest generation. I'm wearing an original PlayStation 23-year-old t-shirt right here.
My favorite piece of PlayStation 2 swag is I have a PlayStation 2 ashtray from like an event back then.
Nice.
When there was still smoking in bars.
I bought a PlayStation 2 extremely late. Like the PS3 was already well underway. Yep. I bought it while I was in college because I had never owned one and I wanted to play a bunch of PS2 games. And I kept that PS2 that I bought used off Amazon in college into my adult life. And until a year, I moved here a year and a half ago. And until I moved here, I was still using it as my dedicated DVD player.
Wow.
Yeah.
I think it was a tank.
I was.
Little triangles to make it vertical?
No. Cool.
So I got a PS2 when I was in elementary school. Wow. I saved my pocket change. I was like, birthday money, come here. And there was an auction at our school for a PS2, and I wanted so bad so I could play Kingdom Hearts. That's like the one game I wanted to play.
Oh, that field, yeah.
And then I backed out because I got scared. I was like, I'm too young for auctions, guys. I can't handle this. And then I saved my money and went to GameStop and got a used one, and I played Kingdom Hearts.
Fantastic.
It's a great time.
Nintendo 64 sold 32.9 million units worldwide. So that's about a quarter of...
About a quarter, yeah.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
So the PS2, 155 million, still the biggest selling console of all time. Beat the Dreamcast, which 9 million.
Yeah.
Oof.
Very sad. And the original Xbox, which sold 24, and the GameCube, which sold 21.7.
Oh, the good old GameCube.
A lot of people had GameCubes around me, and it's always funny to hear that GameCubes sold fewer consoles than the Xbox.
Yeah.
We had an Xbox and GameCube, and I didn't get that PS2 until like way later.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. My dad was like, I want an Xbox. I was like, cool.
So big GameCube kid.
The most powerful system.
So the following generation introduces the notion of what does it mean to win? Because technically, by numbers, the PlayStation 3 won.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sold 87 million units, which is pretty weak compared to what the PS2 had done.
Think back to that era.
Yeah. The Xbox 360 sold 84 million. So they were neck and neck. Yeah. Now, sort of culturally, what we tend to accept is that the Xbox 360 won that generation because it owned kind of the cultural conversation. It owned the mindset. It was like, and there were games
Fox
like
Live,
the GTA San Andreas, stuff like, you know.
It also
San Andreas was PS2, right?
Yes, it was the
end. So we're getting into GTA 4. Like,
it also improved so significantly over the previous generation, while PlayStation,
I guess it was
underperformed compared to
the idea of high def gaming was starting to be introduced as to, you know, like,
I just mean by unit sales numbers. I mean, they outsold their former console and then PlayStation
from
150 whatever units down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
we're debating this in the comments of my articles this week about the FTC, like that specific generation who won it.
And also like Japan, right? Like, Xbox could not, 360 could not find, like, I remember seeing the NPD sales every week, and the Xbox would sell like 100 units in Japan.
And they did that. Remember, they did that initial little push where there was like Blue Dragon and a handful of others. Like
Sakaguchi, was
that Blue Dragon?
Yeah, that was the Final Fantasy.
That's right, yeah. But they managed to sort of like dominate everywhere else. And typically, you know, PlayStation's strength has really been Europe. I mean, it does really well here, but it's such a solid European base every year that they kind of, unlike. And then the other thing is that the PS3 kind of like eked out the win on numbers eventually. That's a really creepy ad.
Yeah, what is?
I remember this.
This is heinous.
Someone showed this to me, and I was like, "How dare you!
I
put this in my life,
Jobert. I hate this."
Mm-hmm. Oh, this is the PlayStation 3 TV ad. Yeah, mm-hmm. Play Beyond.
Oh, that's where the Beyond stuff came from.
Yep.
Okay, and then PlayStation 4, 117.2 million, arguably the winner. However, the Switch is technically the same generation.
Has now
sold 125 million units and is only just now starting to slow down.
That was a whole thing the last 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The argument over whether or not the Switch counted as a Gen 9 console or not.
Well, no, because it was a Gen 8 console.
No, but it was this bizarre back and forth where the FTC was very adamant that the Switch was not a Gen 9 console, and therefore, for that reason, it is not competing with the PlayStation 5 and the Xbox Series consoles. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, Microsoft was pointing out, okay, yes, number-wise, it's not a Gen 9 console, but that's like very inside baseball. No one's going around talking about Gen 9 consoles. consoles, they are talking about next gen consoles and or current gen, I guess, and Switches. Current gen. It is the current Nintendo console.
It's sucking time and money out of the market right now.
Like, it is.
When you have a choice of what to do tonight, you're still one of the things you might do is play something on a Switch.
Yes.
So it's a competitor.
Yeah. It was a whole thing. Like FTC was getting into, Microsoft pointed out you go into a store and there's three consoles on the shelf and those are the three that are competing, which they're correct. Yeah. FTC pointed out, sure, but a lot of things are on shelves at stores. What we're trying to figure out is where the market effects will be felt. And it's not going, the Nintendo is not in that argument. And so very dependent on who you end up believing in that discussion. But I really just wanted someone to stand up in the middle of the courtroom and go, Gen 9 is not a thing. No one uses these terms in reality. It does not matter. But no one got there.
So the PS4 and Switch are both well over 100 million. Xbox One sold 58 million.
All right. Shall we talk about some crazy times in the console war?
There are a few moments that I think kind of have defined it. So the first one we already mentioned, which is Genesis does what Nintendo don't, which I think was the first sort of encouragement of this kind of tribalism that has since emerged about defending one
over
the other.
That's a good way to put it. That's when that started, where it's like, I am actually a Sega person.
Yeah.
People weren't saying that about, I'm a Coleco person.
Yeah.
Like, that's the Connecticut Leather Company. They made belts and Cabbage Patch Kids. Oh, nobody sided with them. But they had Donkey Kong.
So, arguably, I think the largest shot ever taken in the console war was in 1995. So it was E3. Sega had said, here's the Saturn. It's $399. Oh, and by the way, we just sent 30,000 of them to stores. Everyone's like, wow.
So that's never happened since.
Never happened before. Like, you can go out right now and buy one.
And it's out there.
That wasn't the big shot.
Yeah.
The big shot happened, I think it was a day later, at Sony's press conference. Steve Race, who was the president of Sony Computer Entertainment at the time, walked out on stage up to the podium and said this, $299, and walked away.
We're going to do a short speech on the pricing of our new console. And then he walked up and said,
yeah, $299. Just said $299 and then walked away.
Wow.
Amazing. And that destroyed the Saturn
and was
immediately.
The first two CD-ROM widely marketed systems. And I mentioned this to John, but like there were other systems out at that time that were like $800 too with a CD-ROM.
And yeah, the 3DO was there, and
so it was like a really big price point.
Dang.
And they probably took a loss, and that was the first time I really understood that you take a loss in your system and sell a bunch of software. It's totally fine.
Yeah, Xbox is still doing it.
That's what they say.
They say that, yeah.
We can't even make money off of our system.
Yeah.
We're losing. They're losing money making Xboxes. That's what they're telling people.
Everybody does.
So then the next sort of like significant kind of exchange between companies that was sort of really damning came in 2013. So Microsoft had that disastrous E3 introducing the Xbox One.
With the Kinect as a mandatory bar.
And then the real thing was you need an online connection to authorize the game.
And you have like this group of friends and family that you can play your games with, but that's it. Like
they were
trying to pitch us up on this, but everybody's like, okay, so you can't sell your game and you can't do
that. It was basically the disc is a security key for access to the game. The console needs to be online. You won't be able to play offline. There were all these rules. It was like super damning. So then I don't know if you remember, but Sony tended to go last at E3. They would always do the finale of the pre-event things. So this was when Jack Tretton was in charge. Jack had a tough ride because he'd been there a long time and he'd been there and a sort of around the problems that they'd had with PS3, and then he kind of inherited things when they were,
have a spokesperson like this now.
No.
Oh,
I mean,
no.
It's Jim, but Jim's nowhere near as charismatic as any of these guys, right?
He hates being, can tell he hates being up there.
So I think this moment is that, so I ran the official PlayStation magazine for like between 2000 and 2008. So I knew a lot of these guys because they were in the PS2 thing. I had never seen Jack as happy as he was at this moment. So he walked out, and first thing he announced was that the PS4 doesn't impose restrictions on used games.
And this is a day after the
This is a day after. We don't impose any.
So they were reacting.
What we understand happened was they completely rewrote the Sony press conference to respond to Xbox.
Wow.
So it's like, we don't impose any restrictions on used games. You can lend any game to anyone you want. You can play any game you want on any system. You don't need to be online to play or authenticate. Single player offline doesn't require you to check in online. And the crowd just went nuts.
Yeah, there's all this hooting and hollering. It was crazy.
It's so goofy. And like the handoff with the disc, like that image.
Is it? Look at him. He's so happy.
Yeah.
Because, like, I mean, Jack used to run sales at PlayStation, right? And he inherited the top gig. And then, like, this was sort of his big kind of like, all right, we're rolling out a new console. Mm-hmm. And Microsoft just gave him a gift.
Yeah, they just handed it.
They handed this generation to him.
How fascinating to probably be very nervous about this presentation for several weeks, like not know what is going to happen, and then watch the Microsoft presentation.
Yeah. And then
you've got
your communications team being like, basically, if you go out and just counter literally everything that they just said, everyone's going to love you.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I remember this.
That was it. Step one. Share the game. And
they have their diss track they release too.
Yep.
And you can just hand the game to somebody else. So, like, I think these were the big moments, I think, where, you know, Sony had always been very good at being consumer first and being a gamer first. And, you know, and I think their image has changed since.
Yeah. I mean, they don't have backwards compatibility. I think Xbox has done a lot to make it more consumer first. Like, they obviously learned a lot from the TV, just Kinect, everything, threw it all away, changed entirely. Whereas PlayStation has been so happy to be where they're at, it seems like they're taking some things that are consumer first.
There have been a couple of moments if you go back and you just look at the numbers, PlayStation has basically won every generation, every numbered generation. Mm-hmm. And there have been moments of sort of corporate hubris. And the first one was PlayStation 3, and they kind of took a hit. And it was the price, and it was sort of aggressively ambitious.
A nice steak. If you want a burger, go somewhere else. Like, it was crazy.
And it was them putting technology over games, basically, for the first time. And it didn't really work. Yeah, remember the cell processor, the thing they worked with IBM?
Right.
And there was this idea of, you know, they've all been flirting with this idea of all the consoles in the world will connect together and be able to do things. And that was the first iteration of that. And then I would argue that some of their hubris from that era is, we're seeing a little bit of it right now with PlayStation 5 as well, where there's this bit of like, we're the big dog. You don't want to mess with us.
I mean, not to keep dragging it back to the trial, but that some of what we've seen in the trial this last week has been a lot of Sony going, we do all of these things. We have these exclusives. We have this specific business model. We're doing X, Y, and Z. If Xbox were in our position, they'd do it too.
And I think if you give them
Activision,
there's an underlying, well, we earned it, you know?
Yeah.
We didn't buy it, we earned it.
Yeah. It's the whole line that I can't remember if we got to earlier, but the idea of Jim Ryan saying, "Oh, well, I don't think it's anti-competitive that Starfield is exclusive. I don't like it, but I don't think it's anti-competitive, because if he said that, well, he'd be in trouble because they're grabbing up lots of exclusives. They're paying for tons. I mean, that was a big thing that was mentioned in the trial, is that they're paying for Final Fantasy 16 exclusivity. Yeah. And, you know.
So I'm going to put you three on trial now.
Uh-oh.
Because it's time for Video Game 20 Questions.
Oh, God.
So to remind you all of how this works, you'll ask me 20 questions about a mysterious video game, and they should be yes or no questions. Mm-hmm. We generally don't ask questions about the title of the game, like does it start with A, like stuff like that. And that's basically it. So this one this week comes from Kameona. He says, thanks for keeping me company on my daily runs. I really think that, and this is a little bit of a clue for y'all, the Redacted hurt this game at times, and it would be great to see this game get a second life on the Redacted.
Mm. All right?
So let the questioning begin.
Oh, I have to go first, don't I?
No,
there's no rules? First. Okay. Someone else go first.
I usually just shout stuff about, you know.
Does it star a custom character?
A custom character?
A character you make.
Oh, no.
No, okay.
Given the redacted comment, is it a PlayStation game?
No.
Is it playable in some sort of handheld form?
Most things are.
Oh, right, because this
is... Yeah.
I'm actually going to go with yes on this.
Okay.
Because
some older games also got mobile ports, like BioShock, which is...
weird. Agony.
Yeah.
All right, I'm changing my answer to a no on that then.
Okay.
Because I don't want to throw you off too.
It wasn't ever marketed.
No, in a dedicated handheld
form. It wasn't marketed as a...
If you clarify it as that, as a dedicated...
In a dedicated handheld form. Okay.
Okay.
That's what I was going for. Yeah.
Handheld game. Notes. So, such a good idea. We've never thought
Very
of that.
Very smart.
It's just what I do.
It's so brilliant.
Are there companions that accompany the main character on their journey?
Yes.
Okay.
Was the answer to custom character yes or no?
It was no. It was
that
no.
is a great okay. question, too. I just really like that question.
Thank you.
Okay.
I might help you with this one, too.
Companions, yes. Not a place
you don't have to wait for each other. You guys can just fire them off.
You have a game in your head already, right? No?
It's tricky. Because it's for sure not PlayStation exclusive. It's not a custom character, so it is someone who is designed. It was not on handhelds, but that also stumped Sam a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And we do have companions.
So it's probably a role-playing game.
Yeah. You can ask that.
Is it a role-playing game?
No.
Oh. Damn.
Not an RPG.
Okay, well, now I'm on a whole different thought thread.
Is it an Xbox game?
No.
Not an Xbox game.
Does... the main character use a sword?
No.
Okay.
Not a sword. Okay.
You got 7 questions.
Yep.
Something shooty punchy. Probably.
Those are other ways to kill things.
Was this game released on PC?
No.
Not on PC.
Ooh.
Well, so we've narrowed it down to...
yeah.
So this is a platform.
This is a Nintendo game. That's not a question, Sam.
I would think yes.
Gotta be.
Okay.
So it's
something hindered it. That would have to be the GameCube or the Wii U.
Wii U. Wii U game with companions. That's not a role playing game.
Should we spend a question asking about Wii U?
Yeah. I think so. We're.
Is this a Wii U game?
It is.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Game. Good.
Okay. I know the Wii U.
Okay. I. Skip the Wii U because I was waiting.
I did as well. So
okay, we're the same boat.
This is a weak spot for
me. Terrible. I was waiting for Zelda to come out, and then it didn't come out until Switch.
Wait, but so this opens a lot of possibilities. This could be like a Nintendo game. This could be a platformer. Mm.
But the thing is, I think it probably has to be a Nintendo game, right? Because you have but it's not an RPG. What
was this game developed by Nintendo?
Yes.
Okay. That's 10. We still have 10 more.
There's people listening bouncing up and down.
Can I
actually have nine more and a guess? Is how this works.
Okay.
Use your 20.
Narrow it down.
Is the main character a human?
No.
Not human.
Yoshi? Donkey.
Yeah.
Donkey Kong's not a donkey cat.
But it's not Tropical Freeze because that was on the Switch and that was at. You think it's Yoshi's Crafted World?
Ooh.
Or Yoshi's Woolly World.
But does Yoshi have a companion in that game?
Oh, he has there's a second Yoshi. Does that count? Because you can play
companion.
You can play two player. You can play co-op.
Yeah, I would consider that.
But that was developed by Goodfeel, not by Nintendo.
But it's still Nintendo.
It was still a Nintendo.
You asked if this was a Nintendo game. You didn't narrow.
Yeah, we didn't narrow
it
down to
developed or not by Nintendo.
Yeah.
Wait, that's not how I phrased it.
I don't know. I didn't write down how you phrased it.
Okay. Well. Screw it.
Okay, so not a human lead.
How many questions we got left?
There's no swords.
9 questions and a guess.
I mean, we can...
Is this game combat heavy?
8 questions and a guess. Yes.
It's combat heavy.
What are we missing on the Wii U?
I know, that's a problem, because I don't...
Yeah, okay, so it's not a Mario game.
No, it's not.
what the heck? I don't know, Wii U. What was I?
It's not an RPG. There are companions. They don't use a sword. It is combat.
It's not a human.
Who's punching stuff?
Or shooting stuff.
Or shooting.
Or shooting stuff.
I don't think Donkey Kong ever got a gun.
No. So. I mean, he had one in Donkey Kong 64, but...
Wait, really?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
All I had Diddy Kong Racing. What a great game.
Oh, yeah. I love Donkey Kong 64.
What? I have to look this up.
Donkey Kong's gun? His coconut gun can fire in spurts? This is way off topic.
Okay.
What else is on the Wii U? This is my console.
There are so few things on the Wii U.
I loved the Wii U so much.
You'll definitely get this one.
Will I?
Because it's on the Wii U, as we've established.
Yes, we've established. What was on that?
Is this a multiplayer game?
Yes.
But so many Wii U games have been ported to Switch at this point that the handheld quest, it has to be one of the ones that was never ported.
I mean, I don't think that's true. I think it could have been ported.
Well, because I asked if it was, if there was a dedicated handheld and Switch.
We still have 7 questions.
Yeah, okay. You're no help.
I'm no help. Like my knowledge of Wii U is...
We tend to ask about, genre, type of games, things like that. So just think through some questions that might help narrow down.
So we talked about we talked about swords and we talked about combat, but we didn't narrow into the genre.
No, we don't. We didn't also say who does the combat. We also know it's not an RPG.
Yeah.
You don't know anything about how the game looks, for example. Yeah, I don't want to tip you guys too much off to things, but like these are the general things.
We also don't know main features. So one of the reasons I asked multiplayer is like,
It is
we don't know if it's 2D or 3D. So that could be a.
Yeah.
I mean, it could be first person, I guess.
Could be.
It's multiplayer.
But it also has companions.
Yeah.
I've just like completely forgotten every game that was ever released on the Wii U.
I don't remember if...
This is 20 questions amnesia. It totally happens.
Oh, yeah.
So for 14...
I mean, if it's not Mario Maker or Zombie U, I don't remember any Wii U games.
No.
Is your character tiny compared to what would be a normal world?
No.
No, okay.
You were going somewhere real specific with that.
I was.
But they said it. But we said it's combat heavy. We established that
it is combat heavy. There is combat.
Okay.
So is it a shooter?
Yes.
It is a shooter. Okay. What shooters were there on?
Well, now I'm lost.
Was there a
shooters?
I mean, did Treasure or anything do it? I mean, they would have been through Nintendo though. Yeah.
Yes. Well, it's not. Produced by Nintendo.
I thought I asked. I don't remember what I asked now.
Specify that.
Did I
just ask, is this a Nintendo game?
Is that what I asked?
Mm-hmm.
I think so, yeah.
Okay, well, now I don't think Nintendo developed.
We're at 15.
Shooter with companions.
Mm hmm.
Non human. Multiplayer.
Yeah, non human. That's the weird.
That's killing me.
4 questions and a guess.
What's left? Shooter?
Let's do your Hail Marys.
Wait! Star Fox. That stupid Star Fox game.
Oh.
There are companions. That's what I was thinking but I don't know what the
game
is called.
And the
Star Fox with the figures. It's a shooter, it's combat heavy, it's companions. Was it multiplayer?
I think.
Probably. The handheld part works too because of the
view.
What the heck was that game called? Star Fox what?
I actually looked this up recently too, so I'm kind of mad that I don't know.
We were talking about it for some reason. Oh, I know why, because they were speculating that there was going to be a Star Fox game at the Direct. That's right.
That's what I was
Star Fox Ah. Started with an A, maybe? Star Fox Ah.
Does the main character have fox ears?
Yes.
Okay.
What was this game called?
I was trying to figure out the game name.
Star Fox, Star Fox, what? Oh my gosh.
It was a bit sort of Jet Force Gemini-like, right? If I remember rightly.
I played a demo of it once at... Because Ubisoft was involved, right?
Do a barrel roll.
I think. I played a version of this at some E3 event. It must have been E3, like, 2017. I think it was my first E3. And they had all the little figures you could scan. Yep. It was a massive flop.
Yeah.
Star Fox what? What was it called?
Oh my god, there's people tearing their hair out.
I just straight up don't know.
Star Fox Adventures is something else, right?
Yep.
Star Fox...
You can ask a few things to try to narrow down the title, or you can just take a stab.
Does the title include the word Star Fox?
Yes.
Well, we know that.
Well, you know.
Yeah. That's
from her cunning ears question.
Okay. Well,
you got two questions and a guess.
Star Fox in title.
I've been in this position before. It's no fun.
No.
Is there... is there, aside from the word Star Fox...
Oh my god.
I was asked about the title, but we're going to do it this time.
I don't... What do you want?
I know, it's good. It's good. No, I encouraged it.
Is there only one other word in the title aside from Star Fox?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, it's not Odyssey.
It's not Odyssey.
Got one question and a guess.
Star Fox.
Does that word start with an A?
No.
Okay, well, no, that's helpful. That gets me off that track. Star Fox.
Now we have to guess.
No, that's fine. Star Fox.
This is it. You got to guess the name of the game.
Star Fox.
It's very much not
Star Fox.
Star Fox. Star Fox.
Are you phonetically going through the alphabet right now?
Yes! What do you want? Do you have better ideas?
It's a good mind palace.
Star Fox. No, Star Fox. No.
Great. Star Fox. Good radio.
Star Fox. Oh. I don't know.
I'm just trying to think of like all the other things that come as like Star Fox War, Star Fox Adventure. Obviously not that.
We might need a little nudge, Sam.
I've given you some nudges.
I guess I'll be yet.
You're not listening. It's very much not an A.
Yeah.
Very much not an A.
Star. This is not a guess. Star Fox U. No.
All right, we have to wrap this episode.
We do have to end the show.
Name of this game.
Stop looking at me.
We lost it. It's okay.
Has a number in it.
Is it zero?
It is zero.
Ah!
Star Fox Zero, yeah.
Yep, there it is.
Star Fox
2016.
Zero? There it is, yep, yeah.
We gave it a 7, I believe.
Really?
Let me look it up. Yes, it's for the Wii U.
Oh my gosh.
7.5.
That's so foxy.
I think we wanted to subhead this one Zero Fox Given, but we were
yeah.
Oh,
that I made up for it when I reviewed Star Fox 2 and subtitled it A Fantastic Miss for Fox.
Oh,
that's great, Sam. Wow.
Almost there.
Almost
really
there.
Good getting to Star Fox. Weird shooter on the Wii U. It does have multiplayer, but it's you remember this if you were at E3 at the time.
Yeah.
You actually went and they had all these Wii U pad games that were like kind of not part of Star Fox, and they added them into Star Fox Zero.
Yeah, yeah.
This is the most gameplay I've ever seen.
Yeah. I did not play this. I absolutely did not. I played this one time at E3. But
you actually came around to Star Fox by a very roundabout way of questioning, which I've never heard on Game Scoop before, so congratulations.
Thank you, thank you. Good job.
In my heart, we got that right.
I know, I mean, you know.
We knew what game it was.
We were next door.
It was very well done. So let's wrap this one. Thank you, John. Thank you, Miranda. Thank you, Reb. Thank you, Jobert, the one-man army behind the scenes. We have one person in the studio doing everything today. Cameras, scrolling the script and reading right now.
Nice job.
And just helping out with everything. So good job, Jobert, and with the great footage behind us talking to. This has been Game Scoop, and we're out. Damon will be back next week. Thank you.